Hi, I'm Nate with SuperfastCPA, and in today's video, we are going to cover calculating the basis of assets purchased to be used in a trader business. And we're going to do this in SuperfastCPA fashion, which of course is going straight into some practice questions. If this is the first thing you've come across from us, this is the basis of our study strategy, which is using the MCQs as your primary learning tool. So instead of wasting a bunch of time confusing yourself with video lectures or reading the textbook when you have zero context about what's actually going to show up in the questions, you can save yourself a ton of time per topic by just going into the practice questions and learning from the questions. So again, if you've never seen anything from us, the best place that you can start after you watch this video or pause this and go sign up for one of these is our free study training webinars. So we teach you how to study strategically on these free 1 hour webinars. The thing I always say is these webinars are literally 1 hour that will save you months and months of time and get your life back months faster than you would otherwise. We cover the six key ingredients to every successful CPA study process in these webinars. And when you're doing all six of those things in your study process, it's honestly hard to go wrong. So make sure you go and sign up for one of those. All right, so with that out of the way, we're gonna go straight into these questions. I guess one other thing, in this free video, we'll have five questions that we cover. And then in our members area, the full video is 10 questions. So for all of these topics, these application type topics throughout the AICPA blueprints, these free videos that are on YouTube and on our website, we cover five questions, but for every topic we have 10 questions. So the full video will be actually 10 questions. All right, so getting started here. So Jessica purchased a commercial property with a cash payment of $80,000 and a loan of $120,000. Additionally, she paid $500 for an environmental inspection as required by the lender and $300 for a property survey. So what is Jessica's basis in the commercial property? So pause the video. Don't just watch me go through this. Pause the video, reread this if you need to, and then, you know, press play when you're ready to see us go through the explanation. All right, so let's go through the explanation. So the answer is D, $200,800. So let's see how we got here. So Jessica's basis in the commercial property includes the cash payment, the loan, which is a debt that she's taken on as part of the acquisition, and any additional costs directly associated with the purchase. The environmental inspection and property survey are direct costs of acquiring the property, and therefore they're added to the basis. So now we're simply adding these things up. 80,000 plus 120,000, we're at 200,000. So 200,800, which is done here. So the answer is D, 200,800. So the key takeaway from this problem is that, of course, the cash paid, any consideration given for the acquisition. So in this case, it's the cash paid and then assuming a loan of 120,000. So that totals 200,000. And then any other direct costs related to the acquisition would be included. Now, there are some things that might seem related that wouldn't be included, and we'll get to those as we keep going on these practice questions. So now let's go to the next question. So in this question, Smithson Enterprises recently purchased a high-end computer system for $20,000 to use in its graphic design business. In addition to the purchase price, the company incurred $400 in shipping fees and $600 in installation costs. The computer system is expected to be used 80% of the time for business purposes and 20% for personal use. So, what is the correct depreciable basis of the computer system for Smithson Enterprises? All right, so again, pause the video, make your own attempt at this first. All right, so let's see what the solution is. So the answer is C, 16,800. So the depreciable basis for the business asset again, is the total cost of acquiring the asset and preparing it for use. Now, the wrinkle in this question is that it's only going to be used 80% of the time for business use. So you would first calculate what we did in problem one, which is the total basis. Well, not the basis, the total acquisition cost. And then because it's only going to be used 80% of the time for business purposes, we would multiply this. Well, I guess first let's do step one. So the calculation of the basis would include the purchase price, the shipping fees, and the installation costs. So everything here, so we'd be at 21,000, and that's what we have here. Since the computer system will be used 80% for business, the depreciable basis is 80% of the total cost. So you'd take the 21,000 total cost, times it by 80% of the business use, and you get 16,800. So that is the correct answer. All right, let's go to the next question. So in this question, we have John Smith has recently purchased a piece of equipment for his business at a cost of $70,000. The equipment is classified as a 7-year property for depreciation purposes. He's considering the Section 179 election to expense the entire cost in the current year. Assuming the equipment qualifies for the Section 179 deduction and there are no limits on the deduction due to business income, which of the following statements is most accurate regarding the tax implications of expensing the asset immediately under Section 179 as opposed to depreciating the asset over the standard 7-year MACRS schedule? So that's somewhat of an elaborate, confusing sounding question. So again, the actual question is, which of the following statements is most accurate regarding the tax implications of either expensing the asset immediately under 179 as opposed to depreciating the asset normally using a 7-year MACRS schedule? So let's read through these. So we're looking for which is the most accurate. So A, the total depreciation deduction over the life of the asset will be greater if the asset is expensed immediately under Section 179. So the total depreciation deduction will be greater. So that doesn't sound right, because the total depreciation 20 years from now will have been the same, whether it was 179 or done under MACRS. It's just the total depreciation amount. Really, that's saying the total depreciable basis. It's not different based on whether it's done through 179 or MACRS. Okay, B, expensing the asset immediately will lead to a lower net present value of tax deductions compared to depreciation over 7 years. That sounds like that's actually the opposite of what is true. Expensing the asset immediately under 179 would lead to a higher net present value, just a higher tax deduction is what you want to know. So that's not correct. There will be a greater tax deduction in the first year if the asset is expensed immediately. Okay, that's sounding right so far. But the total amount deductible over the life of the asset remains the same. That also sounds correct. So far leaning towards C. Choosing to depreciate the asset will result in a quicker recovery of the asset's cost. And again, that's backwards. You recover the asset's cost quicker by expensing the entire thing through 179 versus 7-year MACRS. So let's see what the answer is. Pretty sure it's C. Okay. Answer C, there will be a greater tax deduction in the first year if the asset is expensed immediately, but the total amount deductible over the life of the asset remains the same. Both of those things are true. So, bit of a explanation of 179 in general. Section 179 allows businesses to deduct the full cost of qualifying property in the year it's placed in service rather than taking depreciation deductions over the asset's useful life. This can provide a substantial tax benefit in the year of purchase by reducing taxable income. However, it's important to understand that the total amount deductible does not change, only the timing of the deduction. So that's kind of the crux of this question, is that part right here. When an asset is expensed immediately under Section 179, the business can deduct the entire cost in the year of the purchase. If the business opts for depreciating the asset over its useful life, the total deductions over the 7-year period will equal the cost of the asset. So that's just explaining the general idea behind depreciation. Okay, so let's go on to the, well, I guess it's useful to read these, why it's incorrect. A is incorrect because the total deductible amount, or in other words, the depreciable basis of the asset, is the same whether it's done through 179 or 7 years through MACRS. Choice B is incorrect because expensing the asset immediately generally results in a higher net present value of tax deductions, in other words, a higher tax deduction, as the deduction now is worth more than the same amount deducted in the future. And choice D is incorrect just because it was explained backwards. Section 179 results in a quicker recovery since the entire cost is deducted in the year of purchase. All right, so let's go to the next question. All right, question 4. Quinn, an entrepreneur, acquired machinery for use in her new manufacturing business. The expenses related to the acquisition of the machinery are as follows. Purchase price, $75,000. Shipping charges of $1,500. Setup costs of $2,000, sales tax of $6,000, training staff on the equipment, $1,200. What is the depreciable basis of the machinery? So, pause the video before we start going through the explanation and make your own attempt at this based on what we've learned from the previous questions. As a side note, since I can't resist pointing this out, when you're doing this question by question, like using the MCQs as a learning tool, if you're doing this correctly, you're really understanding, you know, question 1. It won't teach you everything you need to know about the entire topic, obviously, but you just learn what makes that question work, like what is being tested in that question. And then as you go on to similar questions, they will just build on each other to the point where, now, granted, this topic isn't very difficult. This is like fairly easy, straightforward stuff. But the point is, after a few questions, if you're doing this correctly, you should be able to start getting pretty close to answering the remaining questions. And after 5 or 6 questions, you know, you should be able to start getting some questions right. Each question is just a building block in your understanding of this topic. All right, so let's reveal the solution. So the solution is B, $84,500. Again, the depreciable basis of an asset includes all costs necessary to acquire the asset and prepare it for use. So those included the purchase price, the shipping charges, the setup costs, the sales tax. Now the training cost of $1,200, while it is related, it is not included in the depreciable basis. It's an operational expense. That's just a training expense. So it's not part of the depreciable basis. So we're including these, 4 things, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the purchase price, shipping charges, setup costs, and sales tax for a total of $84,500. All right, let's go on to the next question. So question 5, Eagle LLC initiated operations by constructing an office building for its business activities at a total construction cost of $200,000 on a parcel of land that it bought for $80,000. During the same year, the land's fair market value was assessed at $100,000. Eagle LLC also incurred $10,000 in property taxes. What is the total depreciable basis of Eagle LLC's business property? So there's a key thing in here that you should know from accounting basics back in your bachelor's degree. So part of this question is irrelevant, I would say. So anyways, make your attempt at this, and then we'll go into the solution. All right, so the solution is $200,000. The depreciable basis for a business property includes the costs that are capitalized and related to the construction of the building. Land is not a depreciable asset, so it's not included in the depreciable basis. I just wanted to jump down here. The purchase cost of the land is $80,000, and the fact that it changes in value, none of that's relevant to calculating the depreciable basis of the business property. So the construction cost of the structure is $200,000. So that's obviously included. The property taxes of $10,000 are an expense. They are not a capital improvement. So that's another wrinkle to know. Okay, so the property taxes, unlike the sales tax, so it didn't mention sales tax in this problem like it did in the previous problems. Now, as we went through those and you saw that the sales tax is included in the depreciable basis, you might have assumed that the property taxes were. The property taxes are not. So they're an expense, not a capital improvement, and they're therefore not added to the depreciable basis of the building. So the correct depreciable basis is just the $200,000. So again, in this question, it didn't give us stuff like, let's say, like a title inspection or attorney's costs to acquire or build the building or fees paid to some architectural survey, like direct cost related to the acquisition of the building. It didn't really give us any of those in this question. Or again, the sales tax as part of the purchase. That would be included. But for our purposes here in this question, the only thing that it mentioned that is actually goes to the depreciable basis of the building is the $200,000 construction costs. Now that could have included several of those things I just mentioned. But the point is the land is not included and the property taxes are not included. Sales tax would be included. So the correct answer is the $200,000. Okay, so those were the five questions for this free YouTube version of this video. And again, the best place that you can start if you want more info on our study strategies, which your success on the CPA exams is 100% about the effectiveness of your daily study process. And again, that's what we cover. We teach you the six key ingredients to every successful study process in these free trainings. So this is the link. You can type it into your address bar or just this same link will be down in the description of this video. And again, we will have the remaining five questions inside our members area because we cover 10 questions per representative task from the AACPA blueprints. So I hope you found these five questions helpful. If you did, like the video. If you have any questions about anything, put it down in the comments. And thanks for watching. And again, if you have not, the best place you can start as far as our study strategies and improving your own study process is one of these free trainings. So thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next video.